Hello, hey. Everyone. It's Rach.
And Matt.
And we are so excited to be here with you today on a beautiful Sunday.
Yeah.
If you're joining with us live on hopeyouseek.tv, why don't you head over to the chat? We have our friendly team that are so ready to have a great conversation with you. Why don't you let them know where you are?
Yeah.
On your lounge, in your bedroom, in your PJ still. Sounds comfy. Or if you're watching from YouTube or Facebook, why don't you leave a comment and let us know where you're tuning in from as well? And maybe something that's exciting that's happening in your day.
Totally, that would be awesome. Church, we've received many requests for prayer this week, and right now we would like to join with you in believing for boom for these things. And just a couple of those things that we have today, is we've got a man with failing kidneys, sepsis, and diabetes in need of a miracle, strategic partners in developing and resourcing their business, we've got someone healing from breast cancer, a person struggling with grief and loss, and someone who's after peace and healing for an emotionally abusive person. And so right now, church, we'd love to pray. So Rach, could you please pray for us?
I'd love to, yeah. So God, we just lift every one of these prayer requests up to you, Jesus, and we just thank you that you have won the battle. And we just thank you, Lord, that you just be with each and every person in every season that they're going through right now. And we just pray that you comfort them and that you will be their peace above all understanding. We just thank you that you'll bring beautiful people around each of these prayer requests to uplift and encourage them in this season. We thank you, Lord, for even the boldness and the strength just to send in a prayer request to say that they need help and that they're searching for your presence, God. We just bless that and we bless them in Jesus' name, and we pray for faith in each one of their hearts and that you build them up in Jesus' mighty, mighty name.
Amen. Well, church, our online team are also very ready and here for you. So if there's anything that you need prayer for, just click the prayer request button. Our team would love to connect with you. Or you can send your prayer request to talk to us at hopeyouseek.com.
Miracle. Hello, church. Great to be with you on this very special weekend. I'd hope you see we take two weekends every year where we just focus in on and encourage our people to consider their part, the part that they can play in our legacy giving. This giving is our giving that goes towards our global missions, our local missions, and also all of our church programs and buildings about how we can take them forward. Look, as a church, we believe that God is a God of the generations. I mean, the Bible clearly says that, and that everything He builds, He does through His church family, who is then empowered by His Holy Spirit. We believe that building a godly legacy should capture the spiritual and the natural aspects of our lives. It should capture our prayers, our devotions, our service, and obviously our giving. I mean, over these two Sundays, we've been, lots of people have been really genuinely seeking God about how they can give. And can I ask you, our Hope Online service here today, that you should pray about what part that you can play in this legacy giving, if you are part of the family of Hope You See. If you're visiting, well, I just want to also welcome you today to this service, and we would love to hear from you and get some feedback from you. We have an email address that you can write to. It'll be here on the screen right now, and that you can actually write to us, and we'd love to tell you more about who we are. So when we're talking about legacy, I think a very obvious question that we must and should ask ourselves is, how do you build a legacy? Legacy is one thing, but the next part of this question I always say is, how do you build a godly legacy? I mean, legacy means and implies that something is left to us, or in some cases, something that we leave to others. That is also a legacy. This can be in the forms of many things. It could be your personal testimony, for example, or it could be even a physical inheritance of substance, such as money or land, or even just some valued items, some coins. Or maybe it's a set of books that are treasured within the life of your family, or maybe it's a series of photos that have been handed down and handed down and handed down. Or in some cases, like in our family, there was a special set of china that was handed to Darlene. These are and can be legacy items. But sometimes the legacy that we inherit from our ancestors, from society, and from the generations before us can be a blessing. And unfortunately, they can sometimes also be a hindrance. The book of Proverbs has a lot to say about what we could inherit and the legacy. For example, I want to just read a couple different Proverbs to you, not all of them, because there are so many, but Proverbs 10, verse 7, I think we've got this on the screen here right now. We have happy memories of the godly, but the name of the wicked person rots away. There's a sense there, right there, about legacy, about the feeling that it can actually have and can be transferred. Another proverb, Proverb 13, verse 22 says, good people leave an inheritance to their grandchildren, but the sinner's wealth passes to the godly. I'm sure you've heard about that verse many times. The most common way that legacy or inheritance is handed down is to the next generation is through natural family biological lines. Well, that's good, but in the kingdom, let's come back to a spiritual sense. This also includes the family of faith. I mean, Paul went to great depths to pass on his legacy of his understanding of his relationship to Jesus Christ and transfer that down into other churches. Biblically, we understand that God's kingdom is built generationally from foundation through to foundation through the family of God. The Father established a family on earth, and it's called the church, of which you become a part of when you surrender your life to Christ, which the apostles write so wonderfully about in the New Testament and remind us that Christ is the head of this church. He is also part of our legacy. In Colossians chapter 1, there's a beautiful hymn that was written there, really, I suppose, just simply a number of verses, paraphrase that all the way down to say that Christ is enough. But verse 18, I want to pull that out for you today, and it says, Christ is also the head of the church. Remember, this is God's legacy on planet Earth, which also is his body, the Bible says. Legacy isn't just about what we get. Legacy isn't just about what we get to build, but legacy is also what we get to set in motion. I remember a moment in my life as a young father and wondering, what legacy will I get to leave behind? I mean, I didn't actually have much in my hand at that moment. And to be honest, it was stressful just to make ends meet. So the hope of actually passing something down to my children or my grandchildren or my great-grandchildren were just very minimal. And it was a sadness that came across me. And I just felt, God, I've got to do something. And I felt the Holy Spirit nudge. So practically, I turned that desire into the best thing that I could think about. And so what I did is I went and bought the biggest life insurance policy that we could reasonably afford. And I said to Darlene, I've put legacy in motion today for our family, for our children, and for our children's children. Maybe, again, I didn't get to benefit from things that have come down to me at all, but I was going to actually become the person in our family that was going to put things in motion. See, your story does not begin with you. We are all custodians of moments in history. Some of you and to some degree, I stand on the shoulders of men and women of God that have gone before us, definitely when it comes to the kingdom. We are stewards today within this church and our leadership influence on what others have done before us. And I just think it's an important thought to hang on to, which means then that we, if you are stewards, if you're custodians of this moment, number one, we better treat that thing that we've received, that legacy, that inheritance, as a precious thing. We better actually not trample that down or disrespect that. I can't stand it when people actually disrespect their paths, because this is the story that has got them to this point. Sure, there can be disappointments, hurts, and pain, but to be honest, that's the things that have made you who you are today. So your legacy has brought you to this point. But as I already said, you have the opportunity, you can make decisions today, you can put things in motion to actually change, better, or lift the legacy yet in front of you. Well, one of the Bible characters that we love to talk about when we're talking about legacy is Abraham, who the writers of the New Testament call him the father of our faith. These are, again, shoulders that we are standing on. So again, there's lessons that we can learn from Abraham about how he did this journey of legacy. So if you've got your Bibles there, I'd love for you to turn to Genesis chapter 12. We're going to read the first couple of verses. And it says this, the Lord said to Abram, and remember, this is his original name before God asked him to change his name to Abraham. He says, leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. all the families on earth will be blessed through you. So today, I'd love in this legacy weekend to just unpack those verses for you. I've got five principles, five keys, five ways about how you can start a legacy journey for yourself, for your family, or for those people just simply around you. Number one, the king and his kingdom must be first in your life. I'm giving you principles today about how to build legacy. See, in that Bible verse, the opening line says, "The Lord said to Abram." I mean, this is the first time we see anyone in Abraham's family, his extended family that we understand of, that the scriptures have recorded, where they hear the direct voice of God. Abraham, because of God speaking to him, did the right thing, by the way, and left his family's place of origin. In that place of origin, Bible scholars would say that there was something like 200 different gods that they worshipped. And God was speaking to Abraham and said, come on this journey and worship the one true God, Yahweh. I mean, in our day and age today, you cannot build the kingdom principles, the kingdom ways into your family while you engage in many other options in your life. Jesus said it this way in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, he said, seek the kingdom of God above all else, and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. I mean, just think, when Moses walked down from that Mount Sinai with those stone tablets, and the very first thing, the number one thing on that list was, you shall have no other gods before me. I mean, this is an important value in terms of the legacy story of our lives. Does God's kingdom, does God himself come first in your life? When you swing your legs off the bed in the morning and put your feet on the ground, what are you thinking about? Well, that should be a good marker for you to go, God, I worship you today. I honor you today. I put you first in all of the decisions, all of the activities that are yet in front of me to happen. I trust that my steps are ordered by you, and I believe and I desire to have you first in my life. My next point is the journey of obedience which Abraham took to God. It required steps of faith. God said to him, leave your native country, leave your relatives and your father's family, and go to a land that I will show you. He didn't know where he was going. God asked him to take this faith adventure. See, for Abram to obey God, he was going to have to forsake the comfort zone of his natural situation. Just think that through. Just meditate there for a second. God was calling Abram up into legacy, but to go on that legacy journey, he had to leave his comfortable place. But not only did he have to leave that comfortable place, and that's one thing, and not all of us like that. No one really likes to be leaving the sense of comfort. But not only did he have to leave, but God was calling Abram to go to a place he did not know. That is typically a place of fear and definitely discomfort. Leave comfort and actually embrace discomfort. That's step two. Leave comfort and choose discomfort. That's part of a legacy story. If you're going to see legacy and miracles activated in your life, you're going to have to get more and more used to that. It requires steps of faith. That's how you build legacy in your life. That's how you build legacy in your family. That's how we build legacy in our church, by leaving the comfortable things and embracing the uncomfortable spaces. My next point is that God's blessings, begin with you. But it's never meant to end with you. Again, in this scripture, as God is speaking to Abraham, his promise. He says, I'll make you into a great nation. I'll bless you and make you famous. He's not talking about Instagram famous. He's saying you will become a blessing to others. When we begin to see and enter into the blessings of God, we must remember that we are stewards and not owners. See, economics in the kingdom is based on the entrustment of resources to people. God's trusting you with the resources and the gifts that he's embedded in you. God's trusting me with the resources and the gifts that he's put into me. Well, the test then, are we holders or are we givers? See, holders think that it's mine. I earned it, it's mine. I'll get to decide when and where and if I actually let it go out of my life. Givers, on the other hand, understand where the power to gain comes from. I mean, they're happy for resources to pass through their hands. I mean, the book of Deuteronomy has this amazing few verses talking to the people of Israel when they were going through the desert, and God is reminding them about this legacy story. In Deuteronomy 8, verses 16 and 18, it says, he fed you with manna in the wilderness, a food unknown to your ancestors. He did this to humble you and test you for your own good. He did all this so you would never say to yourself, I have achieved this wealth with my own strength and energy. Remember the Lord your God. He is the one who gives power to be successful in order to fulfill the covenant he confirmed to your ancestors with an oath. Can I say that you may not feel like there's been good ancestors in your life for you in this area of finance? Then I want to declare over you today, it starts with you. Your children's children will say that they have good ancestors if you choose this legacy story today and actually apply these principles in your life. You can change the future, even though your history might not look like legacy in terms of blessing and honor. You can actually make the future different if you choose that story today. My next point is, walking in legacy allows you to enter into a dimension called God's favor. Again, in these verses that God's speaking to Abraham, he says, I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. I mean, the verse above, we could also rewrite that and say it a different way. What about this language, for example? I will expand those who align with your life and limit those who come against your life. Of course, there is the responsibility then to make sure that your life is worth following. The favor of God is always, let me say this again, the favor of God is always aligned with the purposes of God. As we align to God's will in all we do, which includes our financial stewardship, we can also trust and expect that God's favor will go before us. And my last really key point, I suppose, is your world is not going to be limited by your own life experiences. You might go, well, that sounds contradictory. Again, let me remind you of the verse, God speaking to Abraham, all the families on earth will be blessed through you. Receiving, then stewarding, and then leaving a godly legacy means that the ripple effect of our sacrifice, our obedience, will echo into many generations after us. So your experiences, your world as it is today. That is not going to limit your legacy. But again, you've got to stay diligent. You've got to stay faithful. You've got to put God first in your life and your finances. And then the story of legacy will echo and ripple through the history of your family and the people you touch. See, building the house of God, putting His family first, think about that. We often think about, I've got to put my family first. But we never wonder, or maybe we should change our language and saying, I'm putting God's family first, which is the church. Trusting the location of our lives and our families within God's family, His house. Then I believe God is also then, when we do that, He's at work on our callings and our destinies and laying favor out in front of us. Not only our futures, but God is also at work looking after our back. I want to read to you a whole psalm. I love the Word of God, and I don't ashamed or walk away from it. And I love taking the time to read it in church out loud. And so maybe this is a good chance for you. I'd love for us together, you and I right now, to read out loud. Be bold. Don't be shy in this moment. But I want to read together with you Psalm 91. And we've got it on the screen for you. So I've got all the scriptures there. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. So why don't we read this psalm together? I just think it's such an important declaration that we can make today. It says, those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God and I trust Him. For He will rescue you from every trap and protect you from every deadly disease. He will cover you with His feathers. He will shelter you with His wings. His faithful promise are your armor and protection. Do not be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrow that flies in the day. Do not dread the disease that stalks in the darkness, nor the disaster that strikes at midday. Though 1,000 fall at your side, though 10,000 are dying around you, these evils will not touch you. Just open your eyes and see how the wicked are punished. If you make the Lord your refuge, if you make the Most High your shelter, no evil will conquer you. No plague will come near your home. For He will order His angels to protect you wherever you go. They will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. You will trample upon lions and cobras. You will crush fierce lions and serpents under your feet. The Lord says, I will rescue those who love me. I will protect those who trust in my name. When they call on me, I will answer. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue and honor them. I will reward them with a long life and give them my salvation. Well, thank you for doing that with me today. I love that. What a powerful, powerful psalm that Darlene loves to read nearly every day of the week. So, we've talked about what legacy can do in your life, but how do we become legacy builders, and how do legacy builders build? Well, very quickly, just a couple little thoughts. We build the totality of our lives according to God's Word. Acts chapter 20, verse 32, it reads this. It says, and now I entrust you to God and the message of His grace that is able to build you up and give you an inheritance with all those He has set apart for Himself. One of our values that Hope you see is that the Word of God is our foundation of life. This is the one of the ways that you can build legacy. And it means that you're going to have to trust and align the decisions of your lives to what we know from God's word. My next point is how to be a legacy builder is just to walk in the steps with the Holy Spirit in our lives. Romans 8 verse 14 says, "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God." As sons and daughters of God, we are in His family, in His house. We build legacy through walking in step with the leading of the Holy Spirit in all aspects of our lives. Simply, our value at church is we say His presence is our passion. And how do we become a legacy builder? Well, we lay down our lives, expressed simply through the works of service to other people. John chapter 15, verse 13. This is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. Again, hope you see one of our values simply states community is our heartbeat. See, you build legacy, I build legacy, our church builds legacy as we pour out our lives for other people. Within our church community, for sure, but not only internally, but also to our greater community and externally blessing them. I pray that this message really does go deep into your heart, into your mind, into your spirit, into your soul, and that you get transformed with a passion and a desire to say, I want to live my life, not just this weekend, not just last weekend, but with a spirit of legacy over who I am. Everything I touch, everything I do is about today and the future. What can I learn from the past so that I can be better in the future? How do we leave things better than how we found them? What an important, simple value. How do we leave planet Earth better than how we found it? How do we leave this life better than how we found it? And again, I just think that's a great challenge for all of us to live by day, week by week, year by year. Father, I just pray that today, as you speak to people about their part to play in this legacy weekend, Lord, again, that we'll consider what we can do, that we're willing to lay down and willing to sacrifice to build your family, this family, who we are as a body of Christ at Hope You See, how we can bless so many other people through our missions program, be it overseas or be it local, and how we can actually take this church forward, our buildings and our operations, to make a greater impact because of your kingdom in our communities. I pray that this week people will get revelation, inspiration about their part to play. And we declare all of that in your strong name, Jesus Christ, Savior of the world. Bless your church.
Hey everyone, my name is Pastor Steve. I'm from our Maitland campus. Have you ever been to one of those beautiful old churches built in the 1700s or maybe the 1600s? Maybe a European church where you walk in and just look at the splendor and magnificence of it all and can't help but think about God. There's this beautiful verse in John 2, and Jesus is actually in the synagogue. He's moved the money tenders and pushed people out because he wants the house of God to be a place of worship. And he says this crazy thing to the religious people of the day. He says, "Destroy this temple and I will raise it again in 3 days." Well, the people were just astounded. What do you mean? You can't build this. This took many decades to build. But he wasn't actually talking about the temple. He was talking about himself as the temple. You know that God is not interested in a building. He's not interested in a sacrifice without obedience. He's actually interested in your heart. The verse continues in John 2, and it says, "When Jesus had died, after he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken, because 3 days later, his body was raised again. It was fulfilled. And all we have to do is believe in him, not believe in a system or believe in a building, but believe on the name of Jesus. You know, I'd like to invite you to make that decision today, to believe that Jesus is after your heart, that he actually wants to live inside of you and relate with you and be your king and be your savior. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I'd love you to follow as I say this. Jesus, I just thank you that you are interested in my heart. Jesus, I believe in you today. Come into my life. Give me your love and joy and hope, and let me follow you all the days of my life. Amen. Beautiful. If you prayed that with us, please let us know. Click or put in the chat. We'd love to reach out to you and help you with next steps and congratulate you. We're going to move on to celebrate communion together. So if you can, if you've got something, got some a Milo and a biscuit or whatever you've got near you, we're going to remember Jesus. Remember the amazing man and teacher he was. Remember the death that he went to, doing the Father's will, and remember that he has risen again, that he is alive, that he is with us, and he is for us, and he is in us. You know, the blood, which is represented by this juice or whatever you have, means life. Blood in our body means life. It brings life. So as we remember you, Jesus, we celebrate the life that is in you. Thank you, Jesus. This signifies his body that went to the cross, was beaten, was whipped, was put into shame, but was restored by the power of God and lives forever. Like we do when we call upon the name of Jesus and are saved. We live in eternity with him. Amen. How good is it to remember Jesus? I encourage you to do this daily. Do it at home, at the dinner table, with your family. Continue to remember what he's done for you.
Jesus, you reign above it all.
Well, thank you, Pastor Mark, for that incredible message. Church, if anything stood out to you in today's message, please feel free to hang around in the chat, where our friendly team would love to talk and pray with you about anything.
Yes. Well, church, generosity is a part of our DNA, and we are so, so thankful for your beautiful gifts that you give. If you would like to give today, you can do that at the Hope You See app, or you can jump onto the Hope You See website as well to do that. We would also like to remind you that we've got a fancy new QR code that you can scan. It should be on the screen somewhere.
Hanging around.
There. but if you grab another device or your phone, and if you scan that, that will take you to the Hope You See website, and you can see everything that's happening in the life of Hope You See. It's really cool.
Definitely is. And church, we've loved being with you today, but it is that time for us to say the blessing. So join with us.
Yes.
I pray that God, who is the source of hope, will fill us completely with joy and peace because we place our trust in Him. Then we will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Have a great week, church.